Hey guys, we're back. This time we're taking a look at the Hammerstrike AMG faction for GKR's heavy hitters. This guy feels like he's a missile-heavy boat. I'm not really sure what the numbers are when you total them out, but you'll see he carries a lot of missile-type weapons and has some interesting special abilities on some of the weapons as well, which make him kind of fun to play. Anyway, we're going to get right in and take a look how he compares to our other factions. First thing we're going to start with here are the sentry guns, and these you may or may not have. They came with the Wastelands expansion. They basically allow you to place a sentry gun in place of tagging a building, and you don't get to draw a sponsor card. That's the only trade-off, but they do shoot at anyone who approaches the building, which is kind of neat. They have a 900 speed, which actually sounds really impressive until you realize that is the slowest sentry turret of all of the factions, but still nice to have there. Onto our repair unit, Sawbones, which have the second fastest repair unit of all the factions, which is very nice. You're going to be going up in there pretty quick. Onto our combat unit, we have a Honey Badger. Honey Badger is the fastest combat unit, so he's going to be firing first as far as all the combat units go, which is always a nice thing, definitely worth keeping in mind. And then onto our recon unit, Evil Eye, which I love the look of that model too. It's like a very heavily armored drone. It's pretty cool. And Evil Eye there is the fastest recon unit as well. So you make up for having the fastest recon in combat versus having the slowest turrets. I can live with that. Definitely a nice pack of support units for Hammerstrike here. So for our primary weapons here, we got two missiles, two ballistic, no energies for primary. So keep that in mind when you're playing against Hammerstrike here. First up, we have hit and run missiles, 500 speeds, pretty mid-range, high for missiles. Missiles are generally slow. Two energy for a primary is nice, 3 to 6 range, gotta watch that 1 to 2 blind spot in there. And then 4 damage is pretty low for a primary, but it's the ability to fire indirectly as well as the special ability on here. On a successful hit, any support units that can spot the target with line of sight can move. So it gives you an extra maneuverability while you're making an attack with your primary weapon. Nice combo there, low energy, low damage though on a primary is kind of hurtful, especially if you're going for a combat win. Next we have the Peekaboo missiles. Super slow, that's common with a lot of missiles. 2 energy is nice for a primary. 2 to 4 range is alright. You only have that 1 range blind spot, which you kind of expect with missiles. 5 damage is very respectable. And then the really cool thing about this is the special ability here, which basically allows you to move, fire the weapon, then move back. So you can actually fire from behind a wall, step out, take a shot, step back. Makes it so it's harder for people to return fire against you. It's also missiles, so it can be fired indirectly as well. But that special ability is kind of a neat thing where it basically just allows you to pop out, make the shot, pop back. You can even be range 1, drop back to range 2, fire the missile, drop back. And that can really make this unexpected in certain situations, especially when somebody tries to get right up on top of you to prevent you from firing it. Next we have the nail gun. It's a ballistic weapon. 250 is really slow for a ballistic weapon. 3 energy is kind of pricey, but again it's primary, so you kind of expect that. 1 to 3 range is alright. 6 damage is great. And if you deal 4 or more damage, the target's immobilized next round. Can't move, but they can rotate their facing. It's a really powerful ability to use against a heavy hitter to stop them from being able to maneuver to where they need to go. All they can do is turn. And getting 4 plus damage on a 6 damage weapon isn't that terribly hard. Next we have Indecent Exposure, another ballistic weapon. Pretty high speed on this one. 2 energy for 5 damage is nice. The range 3 to 4 is really its limitation, that blind spot at range 1, 2. And if you're shooting at somebody who's not in cover, it actually bumps that damage up to a 6. So, really nice weapon all around there. Not really any fault other than the blind spot you have to keep in mind. Of our choices here, I really lean towards the nail gun. I like its ability. Then maybe the peekaboo missiles. And of the final two, probably going to put the hit and run missiles last. the indecent exposure. There's a nice weapon, 2 energy for 6 damage, possibly. You really can't go wrong with, but my primaries, I'm looking at the effectiveness of the nail guns pinning down your opponent, or the peekaboo missile's ability to allow you to shoot without being shot back at, which is kind of cool. So then our secondary weapons, we've got 2 missiles, 2 ballistic, and a single energy. Definitely worth keeping in mind when fighting against Hammerstrike is that they only have the 1 energy weapon in their entire arsenal, so you can really plan ahead. I wouldn't bother bringing energy defenses against them. So first one we have here is Ring of Fire. Mediocre speed as far as missiles go. 1 energy. The range on this one's weird. It's a 2-2 because it affects everything at range 2 in a circle around you, which is kind of neat. Does 3 damage and attacks each opposing unit at range 2 in your heavy hitter's forward and rear arc. You have to roll to hit each individually, but basically it puts a ring around you. And it doesn't hit friendlies too, which is nice. Kind of an interesting weapon, making sure there's multiple targets at range 2. Might be a little more difficult setting it up. Could take some work, but for the energy to damage ratio affecting multiple targets, it's just a very interesting weapon. Next we have the Claw Missile Salvo. 150, again a slow missile, but 2 energy, 3 to 4 range, kind of standard setup for missiles. 3 damage is nice. If it deals 2 plus damage, you choose an opposing unit adjacent to the intended target, and they take a damage without the chance for an armor save. That can be killer in certain situations. Your enemy heavy hitters in range, you fire the missile at them, and just around the corner is their repair unit, which keeps fixing them every time you damage them. Well, you can do an automatic point of damage to that repair unit by using these. You get a couple of these, you can take out a repair unit pretty easy like that. The no save on that extra damage point is really the nice thing there. One of the better missile options, I think. Next we have our pile driver. It's a ballistic. 550s, pretty mediocre for ballistics. 2 energy, 2 to 4 range, 2 damage. And when you deal 2 damage to a target, it immediately takes an additional damage, so it can do up to 3. Having to deal 2 damage with a weapon that only does 2 damage, you're running the chance that your opponent's not going to roll a single 6. I mean, probability-wise, it's possible. Just not something I'd want to bank on every shot. So don't count on that extra damage, but it's nice when it does go through. Interesting weapon. I don't know if I don't like minimum range of 1 on a ballistic. I guess it's supposed to be like an artillery cannon if you look at the thing. Interesting concept, though. Definitely something to keep in mind. Next we have Hammer Throw, which is another ballistic. This one's super fast. 1 energy, 1 to 3 range, 2 damage. And you get plus 2 damage if it's made against the flank of the target. So a 1 energy, 4 damage shot can be killer, but you got to be in that flank. As a normal secondary weapon without this ability here, it's not all that spectacular. But if you are a good enough pilot and you're good at maneuvering and you can get in and get those flank shots, then that 4 damage for 1 energy suddenly becomes a lot more enticing of a weapon. Next we have Wildcat Strike, which is our only energy weapon. Really nice speed on there. 1 energy, 1 to 2 range, 3 damage. And if it deals 2 or more damage to a heavy hitter, the opponent discards a random sponsor card. That can be a killer weapon. 3 damage needing 2 plus is possible. Pretty probable, actually. They have to save 1 out of 3 shots. If they save 2 or more, you don't get the bonus. But the 1 energy for a possible 3 damage is nice, and making them discard sponsor cards is a huge, huge bonus. Plus, being the only energy weapon, most people are going to see you playing Hammerstrike and expect you're taking missile loadouts. They're not going to expect that energy weapon in there, so they're likely not going to have counters to energy weapons. Of our secondary weapons here, I like Hammer Throw, but the setup for it is a bit too much, so we're going to put that towards the back. Pile Driver's nice, but the chances of that ability going off are lower than some of our others. Ring of Fire is a really cool weapon, but it's also kind of difficult to aim. So I'm thinking our two options here that I'm going to go with would be the Wildcat Strike and the Claw Missile Salvo. That additional damage to an extra target without them getting to re-roll save is awesome on here. And the ability to knock out sponsor cards on there just make this a mean 1-2 punch. So we move on to our orbital strikes, and we got orbital strikes and the orbital shock. The orbital shock was a promo card, so you may not have that. I think it was a Kickstarter exclusive, actually. But the orbital strikes, we have our second slowest, I think. Yeah, so we're going to be going third as far as they fire. It's a great weapon, though. One energy for four damage. Does not require a line of sight. Can hit pretty much any place on the board. They are a destroy after use, so it's a one-shot weapon. Then it goes to your damage pile. You can repair to get them back, but you need to plan ahead, or otherwise you're damaging yourself when you fire those. Orbital shock works exactly the same way, but it's three energy for five damage. It's a little bit extra damage, but a lot extra power, so you need to keep that in mind. But again, you can have any or all of these in your deck. Just make sure that your repair bot's standing by so you can repair them, put them back into your discard pile from the damage deck after use. Next, we have our deploy cards. These basically let you deploy your support units for a cost of 2 energy instead of the normal 4. So you can still deploy guys even if you don't take these, which will give you options for more reaction cards. But at the same time, you really want these to lower that energy cost in order to conserve energy to use movement or fire your weapons. Early on in the game, I've actually held on to these and just spent the full 4. Because that way you can have these in your hand when you need them later. It's not like you're going to be firing a lot of weapons on the first turn anyway, so it might not be worth burning one of these cards because you just basically, you have all that extra energy, you're just going to go to waste anyway. But again, you can choose any or all of these, and what you do basically depends on your playstyle and whether you want to spend the full price or the lowered cost for deploying units. Next we got our movement cards. Everybody has the exact same two maneuver cards here as options. Quick rotation allows you to spin to face any direction. If somebody's behind you, might have a flank shot on you, you can spin around and now you're facing them. They're not in your flank anymore and so on. That's really the main use for that one. It also allows you to spin around to fire at a target that you might originally not have had a shot on. And then jump jets just give you some extra maneuverability to get in range, get out of range, put yourself into cover, and so on. Let me get into our reaction cards. First one we have here are flank defense. And these, pretty much like the quick rotation card, allow you to have a defense or counter versus somebody getting into your flank. If you're a good enough pilot or you can maneuver good enough to keep people out of your flank, then you can skip putting these in your deck and save yourself a couple extra cards for other options. So it really comes down to personal preference if you want to use those or not. Next we have our fake shots, which basically is a reroll of your attack roll if you fail. It does cost you 1 energy, so you have to keep that in mind. But the best use for these is in that off chance that you roll the double 1 critical fumble on your weapon. You can play this real quick, reroll that. That roll doesn't count, the new roll counts. So it allows you to get around that. Plus, who doesn't want a chance to roll again if you manage to fumble on your primary attack that has a great shot on your enemy, and then you roll a crappy attack roll. So nice to have these in there if you can get them to fit in your deck. And then our final batch of reactive cards are the defense ones, and there's missile defense, ballistic defense, and energy defense. And what ones of these you're going to bring really depend on what other factions you're facing, the players you're facing, if you know their playstyle, what weapon types they choose. Like in this case, if you were playing against Hammerstrike, chances are there's only 1 energy weapon in their entire arsenal, so you might not want to bring the energy defense. There's multiple missiles in their arsenal, though, so you may want to bring the missile defense. And so on, like if you're playing against King Wolf, they've got that big dire laser. Chances are you're probably going to want to bring energy defense against King Wolf. So it's all hit or miss depending on who you're playing against. And it's a luck of the guess, basically, on what weapons they bring, because they might not bring the weapons that you're expecting them to. And they might end up being a wasted card. If you bring a ballistic defense and nobody brings any ballistic weapons, then they're dead cards in your hand, and you basically hold on to them, use them for damage when you take damage, so you know you're not losing a system you actually need. But you're drawing these based on what you think your opponent's going to bring, you don't actually get to see what weapons they have until they start firing them at you. So keep that in mind. It's kind of a guessing game of knowing what your opponent can be armed with. As far as the pilots go, I went over all of them in some of the previous videos. I think the King Wolf and the Diamondback video. And they're all the same choices for everybody, so there's really not a point in going into all of them every time. Any one of the pilots is playable with any of the heavy hitters. They really depend on your play style, your weapon choices, things like that. The layout of the board, your positioning, is really going to determine if the pilots are better or worse for you. There are obvious ones in there, like re-rolling your armor saves if you roll ones. There's ones in there for extra sponsor cards, energy conservation when moving, when firing, things like that. Definitely nice to have, but it all really depends on your playstyle as to which is going to be most beneficial. There really is no best pilot for a heavy hitter. It's definitely a personal preference option as far as that goes. So feel free to choose whoever you want, whatever style fits your playstyle, and they just complement everything else. Anyway, that's a look at the Hammerstrike AMG faction from GKR's Heavy Hitters. A very interesting faction, very missile heavy, and has some really cool weapons in there. Curious, I have not actually played this one yet. I've played against it, so I'm curious to see if it fits well with my playing style. I think I can make a decent setup out of the cards, and I kind of pointed out the ones I'd choose, and I'm curious to see how it's going to play out for me. Anyway, that's going to wrap it up for this video. As always, thanks for watching, and we'll see you in the next one.